Ms. Ambrose, please state your name. For the record, please.
Medgar Wiley Evans.
Thank you, sir. And also your age.
I'm 37 years old.
All right. So, Mr. Evans, would you please let the courtroom know your story?
I was born on July 2nd, 1925. June 12, 1963. A few weeks before my 38th birthday. I was born in a little small town called Decatur to a farming family, a great family, a family with structure. During this time on the farm, not only did I have to bale hay, I also had to work in the sawmill. Everybody in the state of Alabama, I'm sure you're familiar with what a sawmill smells like. Yes. Not only that, working on the farm 7 days a week, I had to still attend school, which was very important. A segregated school, where they didn't even want me in the building. But to let everybody know, I think I got my diploma.
Amen.
After that, I had to make a decision. Should I stay at home with my family for everything they instilled in me? Should I go out into the world and see what it is and who it is that I am? Who have I become? I decided to join the United States Army, the United States of America. Made my country proud. I flew over and fought in the Normandy War. During that time, I worked with people from all over the world, different races, different backgrounds. But our common goal was to come together as one and represent the United States of America. So whatever our differences were, we had to put it behind us. Come together as one. But what seems to amaze me, flew back all the way back home after the war was over, back in the United States, still treated as a second-class citizen. That's a fraud! I couldn't drink out of the water fountain unless it had my name on it. The name was colored. I couldn't use the restroom. If I walked into the wrong restroom and it didn't say colored, I had to leave. The most embarrassing part, this is the country I fought for. I was good enough to fight in your war, but I come home where I left raisin and rest my head. Excuse me, my family rest their head. And I couldn't even vote. I returned home, and I couldn't even vote. That's a problem. So, now, I'm sure I have people out here who've been in the military before. We come back home. Everybody praises you when you're over there. But now we're back. What do? There's nothing for us. I'm black, looking for a job. But there's nobody looking for me. So, good choice. I went to Alcorn University, which you all know now as Alcorn State University. During that time, I majored in business administration. I ran on the track team. I played on the football team. I was also on the debate team. And let me let y'all know something. I sang in the choir. I can sing. But that wasn't the greatest moment of my college career. I met a beautiful woman. Her name, Meredith B. When you see me move my hand like this when I mention her name, Meredith B. It's because when she walked across the floor, it was just a golden cloud moving in front of me every time she moved. That's her.
All right, now.
However, I had a beautiful wife. But that wasn't the best of it. She blessed me with not one child, not two, but three beautiful children. My wife. Her and me. That's right. So you know I'm a man, a proud black man, an educated man, a university trained man, back from the military. So what does a real man do who has no job? I enrolled back in school. I tried to apply to law school at the University of Mississippi. You all know what happened? I was denied. I was qualified with the color of my skin. What does that mean? But I'm gonna let you all know something. Back in the day when I was raised on that farm that I spoke about earlier, my father, and you know my mom has some words too, but she's coming out that good book. She said, son, when you have problems, you have to just continue to walk by faith and not by sight. Lean not on your own understanding, and all your ways acknowledge Him, and He'll break your path. So what you have to understand is everything that you see in front of you is not necessarily real. You have to believe in things that you have your faith in.
That's right.
You believe in God and Christ, but you can't see Him.
That's right.
If you have faith, if your faith is as strong as your word and your walk, you'll be pressed on to the other side.
Come on now. Come on.
I bow down to my knees every night. God blessed me to become the first field secretary of the NAACP in the state of Mississippi. You must understand that during that time, I've seen amazing cases. Black people of my race, my color, being pulled down the street while the bodies were alive, chained up to the back of vehicles. When their bodies are going down the road, they're bumping and losing body parts. I was on those cases. Being branded. Being burned. By cigarettes. All kinds of stuff, y'all. One of the greatest and amazing cases was the Emmett Till case. I was on that. However, my mission was to motivate, stimulate, and educate the minds of our black race. To become knowledgeable on the things that we were unsure of, that we did not understand. That was my mission. However, our financial barrier and our financial struggle, what I also did is try to bridge the gap for our black community to understand the value of a dollar. Stop spending money on people that don't support you. Support your business. By trying to do so, my life was cut a little bit short. Let me let you know something. Me and my wife, Murray, made a pact. The pact was, every time we came home, we would get out on the driver's the passenger side of the car. The reason why we get out on the passenger side of the car is because it's closer to the house. When we pulled up in our driveway, I had a carport. If you guys are not familiar with the carport, it's open on all four sides. The only secure side was the side closest to the house. But this particular night, around 11:30 at night, I was leaving the NAACP meeting. It was kind of late. I sat in the car for a while. I decided to get out on the driver's side. Fellas, sometimes it's important that this is your life. Really important. When I got out of the vehicle, I shut the door. At the same time I shut the door, I heard BANG! I was shot in my back by a white man who never let me defend myself. I was shot. The only thing that prevented me from hitting my face on the concrete is my keys that I had in my hand. I fell to the ground and continued to hit those keys in the concrete. I was trying to hold on. My body was on fire. I was burning. I didn't know what happened. I was knocked down. I was talking to myself. The words were not coming out of my mouth. They were just going through my thought process. She couldn't hear me. I heard the door open again. I heard, "Daddy! It was my kid! I was dying in front of my children. I could not prevent what they were seeing. This white man killed me in front of my children. I didn't die there, though. My wife got me some assistance. Went on to the hospital. Got to the hospital. I could see what was going on, but I couldn't move and I couldn't hear anything. They pushed me against the wall. I was shot in my damn back, and they put me on the wall. They didn't work on me until 6 hours passed. 6 hours! But my wife Murphy was able to fight for me when I wasn't able to fight for myself. That's what a real wife does.
I said that.
She told me, "You better work on my husband." They came over and worked on me. The reason why I died is because they didn't stop the bleeding. They could have, but they didn't. But that's okay, because my blood still speaks my message. Just like it did for Jesus, my blood still speaks. Take a trip to Brooklyn, New York. Well, you'll see a university named after me called Medgar Evers University, where we educate, motivate, and stimulate the mind of over 3,000 people every semester. And it doesn't matter what color you are. If that's not good enough for you, I'm going to let you know, my blood still speaks. If you travel down the road a little bit further, what you'll see is a high school named after me. Medgar Evers High School, where we educate young minds, motivate, and stimulate the younger generation so they can function in today's society. My blood still speaks. In 2019, my blood still speaks. In Birmingham, Alabama, in the Bubba Auditorium to thousands of people, my blood still speaks.
Glory.
Doctors, lawyers, educators, promoters, producers, my blood still speaks. Ask about it.
Thank you so much, Ms. Evers. You're with us, guys.
Thank you. Hey, girl. Thank you. Mr. Evers, to you.
Mr. Evers, is it true that you're a troublemaker? You're telling blacks out of the shop and white establishments to try to keep money in the black communities.
Well, to let you know, first of all, I'm not a troublemaker by no means. Secondly, what you must understand, Mr. Holmes, is the black community is the only community that loses their dollar in the first cycle. We'll earn a dollar and spend it out. We don't circulate. So my job is to bring the black race to understand the professionalism of managing money. That's what I wanted us to do. You have to understand, compared to the Asian community, the Asian allow their dollar bill to circulate 7 times with among themselves before it is expected at their culture. Out of their community, out of their race. Meaning, they buy from each other. They support one another. They
all right.
On each other's bills. They don't mind staying together. Yeah. That's all I wanted to do. I'm not a troublemaker.
I see. Well, those are choices people make. As you have made choices. Did you boycott establishments which led to wild riots where people died because of you. Because of you, Mr. Evers.
Mr. Hong, it's so funny having your birthday. It's kind of fun. But what I need to let you know is, when we boycott, a boycott is exactly what it is. Just a boycott. A protest is exactly what it is. A protest. The black race in our movement, we brought peaceful protests. We brought peaceful boycotts. People who look just like you brought me my
You can't object.
People of your color, spit on my way. People of your color,
that wasn't us. Thank you, baby.
People of, that look like you, sprayed us with hoses from the fire department. You all brought the violence. We brought the peace. A protest is just a protest. A boycott in the city is just a city. You did it.
Sir, you got a major part in that. And these boycotts, they sound very exclusive. They're very exclusive, man. Almost along the lines of prejudice. Could it be said that you are prejudiced yourself, Mr. Evers?
I don't have prejudice all in my body. I just want equality.
Let's try to understand equality and justice. If I did what you did, they would have no doubt shot me in the back. No further questions for Mr. Evers. He can go. He's really just a wannabe Martin Luther King.
Oh, whoa, 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 come on. Can I say something to him?
You go right ahead.
Let me educate you one more time. I died 5 years before Martin Luther King. 5 years! So what you need to know is that you can never be number two.